Welcome to the Nerd Party.
Hi, this is Henry Gilroy, co-executive producer of Star Wars Rebels. You're listening to Aggressive Negotiations.
Welcome to a special birthday extravaganza edition of Aggressive Negotiations, the podcast on the Nerd Party Network that looks at the Star Wars galaxy from every conceivable angle and then a couple more that it finds along the way. I'm one of your hosts, Jedi Master John Mills, and with me is my dear friend, who is a standard galactic year older during this recording, Jedi Master Matthew Rushing. Matt, how are you today, you old scoundrel?
It's hard to tell, the old boof milker, looking through this kyber crystal. I like to think that we look at Star Wars through the lens of a kyber crystal. Ooh. So if you turn it, there's always just a different flavor, right?
Ooh, it's like a kaleidoscope of Star Wars. I like that. That works. That's very cool.
Yeah.
Very, very cool. So. But what would also be really cool is if you're enjoying us here on Aggressive Negotiations is to amble on over to iTunes or Apple Podcasts or whatever it's going to be called with the next OS update and give us a review and rating. We would really appreciate it. We will read it right here on the air.
Hey, John, I don't mean to interrupt, but did you know that we got a brand new review over on iTunes?
We got a brand new review over on iTunes. Well, that's great.
We did.
What's it say?
It is awesome. Well, it says, non-toxic Star Wars nerdery, five stars. And I think you would say the iTunes name as Arcona. And they said, to say that Star Wars fandom is a rough place right now would be an understatement. The good news? Shows like Aggressive Negotiations exists. This is one of the best Star Wars shows out there because it is evident that both the hosts are legit Star Wars fans. And because they manage to disagree about things without turning it into a rage fest. They're basically the fans we want to see. Honest and kind, delightful, geeky, and critical, all wrapped up in a Star Wars dork package. Yeah, we're all dorks. Basically, if you're in need of a really good Star Wars conversation podcast that leaves behind the rage of a certain segment of Star Wars fandom in exchange for some honest-to-goodness, fanatic dedication to Star Wars, Aggressive Negotiations is for you. Wow.
What a flattering review. That is terrific. We are so glad, Arcona, that we hit all of those notes. That is exactly what we set out to do. We are fond of saying we're nothing but Star Wars goodness on this show. And this says to me that we're hitting our stride with that. So thank you. That's a wonderful review to get. It really is. So again, be like Arcona. Leave us a rating and review over on iTunes. And go to thenerdparty.com/contact. Drop us a line. Seek us out on Twitter. Our account is at the Jedi Masters, and the network is at Join Nerd Party, and you can find the Nerd Party on Facebook and Instagram as well, which, from what I understand, all the kids are hanging out on nowadays. Jedi Master Rushing, now that you've entered the pantheon of we older, wizened Jedi Masters as of today. Congratulations. Congratulations.
Well, thank you. I like to think of it as a top of the hill party.
Well, I can tell you that you'll be grateful that you don't have to keep climbing because, boy, it gets tough to get up off your chair every day.
It's just
often.
Easier to roll on.
Yeah, exactly. Now. Exactly. Just hang out on the plateau for a bit. So, okay. Your birthday actually has inspired a thought about something that.
Oh, no.
Yeah. Well, no, it's a good thought. It's a good thought. Every so often, you know, we like to throw these sort of like crazy idea conversations out there. But I started thinking about your birthday and the fact that I'm a little bit senior to you. And about that made me start thinking about Yoda, made me start thinking about how there have been discussions over time. How old was Obi-Wan in Star Wars? How old was Anakin at this point? How old was Luke at that point? And the back and forth that can go with that. And I started thinking about it, even in terms of Yoda, when he, you know, when 900 years old, you reach, look as good, you will not. I have to ask, just to get us started tonight, how on earth would you determine age in the Star Wars galaxy if you are traveling faster than the speed of light on a regular basis? And what is the standard measure? And is that applied across the galaxy so that somebody like, is Uncle Owen the same age on Tatooine as he is when he moves to Coruscant? And how on earth – forget the Empire, how would you enforce that during the Old Republic?
Yeah, this is a really great question, because as you were talking, I was just thinking, so is Yoda 900 years old from his planet's perspective?
Right.
But maybe from the rest of the... And so then I was thinking, well, so Yoda kind of... and the Jedi specifically kind of talk about the idea of, you know, oh, for 1,000 generations, you know. And so it made me wonder if Yoda's age is kind of more based on something central, like a Republic calendar system that is on Coruscant, and that's how we tell, you know, a certain age from a character like that. But yeah, then when you get out on a planet like where, you know, you've got Uncle Owen, he's never left Tatooine. Obviously, the year on Tatooine is going to be different than a year on Coruscant or a year on any other planet, because they're going around their suns at different times. So,
right.
Yeah.
See, the way I think I would crack this specific nut, and let me know what you think, is that I think you're on the right track, that Yoda would have been 900 years old as his species reckoned it. And as a result, that means that everybody's age is a little bit, spongier than you would think. You know, Yoda could be 900, but maybe by the galactic standard, he's 1,000 or 1,500 or less, or 500 or something like that. But I think that what it winds up doing, and I don't think this was baked into Star Wars necessarily. Like I think that this is just something that's a pleasing byproduct, as it were, because I think it winds up speaking very much to a lesson that Lucas has story wise built into everything, and that of course carries on, that age and wisdom aren't necessarily married to each other.
That's something that's fascinating to think about, because Lucas does kind of seem to try to show the sides of both, you know, and I'm specifically thinking of like the Clone Wars, as we see kind of like Ahsoka become more of who she is, you know, and who she's going to be. But there's a real sense of wisdom sometimes that comes from her, you know. And it's not because of her age or experience. It's just something that, it, you know, it's like she is able to have that, you know. But we also do see, I think, one of the things I do love about Star Wars is it is something that kind of references the idea of that it is wise to look to those that are older, you know, and to at least listen to what they have to say. You know, we think of Luke running off, you know, in The Empire Strikes Back.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's not a wise decision. It's a really bad one. And he almost dies for it, and so do all his friends, even though he's there trying to save them. So I love the way that Lucas can kind of show both sides of that. And I think it's important because age, whatever it is, whether it's younger or older, should never be discounted. And really, I think what it shows is that age does speak for itself many times. But at the same time, you know, you have to judge each person by their own actions, mm-hmm. you know. So those own those actions then speak whether or not we should listen to them or not. You know, not just because they're old, right?
Right. And I think it's such an interesting area to navigate as well, because there is unquestionably, you know, the question of the impetuousness of youth versus the innate wisdom that you can get, you know, you can gain from interacting with somebody younger. Like, they can give you a different perspective. They've got a different perspective on the galaxy, or, you know, the world, you know, in our world or something like that. But with their different perspective, like, it's about the fact that it's about the perspectives that we come into contact with. And I'll use your favorite, because it's your birthday, I'll use your favorite Jedi as an example. Anakin specifically calls out and says that Obi-Wan is as wise as Master Yoda. And I think no small part of that has to do with the fact that even though Obi-Wan might be viewed as a younger, Jedi, he is still, we see in his interaction with Dex, he's been around and he has built friendships and he has listened to and respected and interacted with so many different people throughout the galaxy that's what matters is he has more wisdom in him than even you could arguably say somebody, let's say Master Windu, who's very intractable, who you can tell is somebody, and this is supported throughout the Clone Wars as well. He's going to tell you what's going on, not listen to what's going on, that there's a very intractable nature about him. And not that he's a bad guy, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah, no, I think you're right, and I think one of those things has to do with and this is something really interesting too when you kind of think of the idea of being beholden to rules and regulations and a certain code. And one of the things I think that Obi-Wan, just as a character, as an example of this, where it's not just his age that has made him this way, but it's his learning to have reverence for the rules, but at the same time also knowing from his experience with Qui-Gon of maybe when it's wise to question those rules, mm-hmm. and or that those rules aren't always necessarily in concrete, right? That there are some things where things are fudgeable, malleable a little bit. And I think, what we see in him as a character is that he's somebody who knows the negotiable and somebody what's non-negotiable. Mm-hmm. Like, there are truths to which Obi-Wan holds that are non-negotiable. We've talked about that before, capital T type truths.
Right.
But he also is very aware of what the small t truths are that can be fudged or changed when needed for the best of the situation there. And I think there's a real wisdom that comes in that. And part of that has been his ability to soak in the wisdom that has come from others at an age much earlier than lots of other Jedi have. And he hasn't fallen prey to as much of, I think what we see in the Clone Wars, Yoda mentions the arrogance.
Mm-hmm.
Obi-Wan doesn't have that arrogance in many ways because he'll be the first one to admit his mistakes to you.
I want to indulge this because, again, it's your birthday and Obi-Wan's your favorite guy. And I want to go back to something you mentioned a couple of minutes ago. And I know this is sort of a rabbit hole and this isn't on the main track, but you've got me thinking here. You talked about when Luke went off impetuously. And Yoda and Obi-Wan are saying, don't go. And I have to question, was that truly their wisdom speaking? Or was it them speaking from fear in that situation about what was going to happen to Luke? Because if Luke doesn't go, which they're selling as their wisdom, then Leia gets captured, Chewie gets captured, Cloud City's under, Cloud City winds up under Garrison anyway. And Han's gone. So Luke going does in fact turn the tide, doesn't it?
Well, this is, the thought experiment then becomes what would happen if Luke doesn't go? And yes, you mentioned Han's captured, Leia's captured, Chewie's captured. So all those people are captured, right? But that we don't know the future. And as Yoda's often, said, that always in motion is the future. And so, but Luke does choose to go, but it is not the wisest decision. And I would argue that it makes sense for Obi-Wan and Yoda to make this argument because they have already seen what the impetuousness of a Skywalker can lead to. And they've already seen the downfall of Anakin into Vader because of the decisions that he made because he wouldn't listen.
Of course.
And so for them, it's like history is just about to repeat itself.
Of course. No, that is unquestionably. But you know, leaving aside, you know, Luke going to Cloud City provides a distraction that maybe puts the guards a little less diligent than they should be for Lando to send the note to Lobot, you know, through his computer hookup and everything like that. But, you know, in terms of Luke, you know, going down that path and everything, let's indulge another one here then, where if Luke doesn't go off, is it possible that Obi-Wan and Yoda had the wisdom to realize that Vader himself would wind up being the end of the Sith in any regard because he was never going to be able to fully realize the extent of his power, if you will? It would have been a dead end for him to ascend.
Yeah, that's a great question. And, you know, I obviously for Anakin, you know, it does if he makes it above Palpatine, you know, he really does have to kind of in many ways do exactly what Palpatine was doing, which was to try and find an apprentice who could surpass him, because he would always have limitations when it came to the amount of power he was going to have.
Mm-hmm.
So, and whether or not Yoda and Obi-Wan know that is a really interesting question, and I think it's even, you know, exacerbated by the fact that we know now what a Force ghost could know.
Mm.
I mean, when you think about the world between worlds and where, you know, Force ghosts go, I mean, I just feel like that's almost like Force Ghost Alley, you know? You know, him and Qui-Gon are walking between things, seeing what's going on, you know? They have this connection. And so, and the fact we already know that Yoda can put himself in that kind of position because he does that with Ezra, you know,
mm-hmm.
And that's a precursor to Ezra getting to the world between worlds. So they have access to immense amounts of knowledge.
Right.
And so that is an interesting question. And it's hard because, you know, going back retroactively now, it doesn't all quite fit in the sense that, like, it doesn't all quite make sense that they would be so fearful if they could have some sort of, you know, vision of the future. So, yeah, it's fun to play all those games, though, with everything that we've got now.
It is. I definitely think it probably goes down the road of what Lucas was talking about in his interview with James Cameron about what he was going to explore in the sequel trilogy, about how, you know, the physical world is just a chess game between, you know, aspects of the Force in the higher plane of existence sort of thing. But to sort of bring it back to the time thing, with Obi-Wan as a ghost divorced from time itself, do you think that there was any inclination for him to go back and revisit those moments? Do you think that there was even the capability for him to, I guess, almost like Marley or the Ghost of Christmas Past or something, go back and see those moments again and try to understand what went wrong, and maybe that informs the counsel that he gives Luke later?
I think you have, I think there's every reason to believe that he could do something like that. Because it does feel like, you know, now that he's one with the cosmic force, but can still, you know, bring his consciousness to bear on the physical world, you know, he does have access to immense amounts of information. And so therefore time for him doesn't mean anything anymore, and could do what we think of, which is time travel between these different points in his existence, and even maybe points in all existence. You never know. So, I mean, we get the feeling from the priestesses that time doesn't mean anything for them, you know, once they have transcended. And so I could totally see him doing that. And obviously, I think that's one of the main aspects of this in the first place, which is for Jedi to learn to do this, it means for them to let go, you know, of mm-hmm. time as we know it, and to trust that what comes next is even greater than what's here. And you know, that's a great spiritual theme there.
Oh, sure.
Of, you know, not holding on and everything. But yeah, just the idea of like that makes for a Force Ghost, time is malleable at that point, where you can just like go in and out of different points of your existence or whoever else's existence, I guess. That's crazy awesome.
And I think that comes back into the whole age discussion that kicked this off, because since the Jedi are aware of the fact that time, and in some regard, they understand that the, you know, Yoda says, luminous beings are we, not this crude matter. Age doesn't actually matter to them at all. So therefore, you know, when Yoda throws out the 900 years, you know, he's saying it just as a way to like, you know, say to Luke, hey, you know, when you make it this far, you know, you see if you look this good. He's obviously making a quip about it. But he knows he's trained Jedi for 800 years and everything. But at the same time, there's that aspect that, you know, while we're sitting here talking about the Force Ghosts and you've transcended, they know that time doesn't really have a meaning. But as sort of a parting note, is it simply that Yoda and Obi-Wan, Qui-Gon as well, are among the Jedi that rediscovered that truth? Because it sure seems that the Jedi tradition, you know, during that Clone Wars era was much more rooted in the temporal world, the physical world.
Yeah, I like what you're saying there, because, you know, you think about when Yoda goes on his trip, and one of the things that he sees is, and when he comes back, he confesses that he doesn't even know if they can win the Clone Wars,
mm-hmm.
but he does know that there is a way to win eternally. It's just, he's not sure when that's going to come. Basically, that's a really bad paraphrase, but.
I think that's the meaning.
I think that that's something that's really important, because like you said, that's the moment where Yoda, I think, begins to see time a lot differently than he has before. And again, what's cool about it is, in some ways, you know, when he says that to Luke there too, he is saying that as a proud thing of like, I have lived this long. My experience gives me the ability to say these things because I have seen ones just like you come and go, and I'm still here, you know, like, but at the same time, like you said, there's this sense for him and for, I think, Obi-Wan and Qui-Gon at that point, that it doesn't matter how long it takes. They just have to get it right, you mm-hmm. know. And so what they need then is for people in the temporal world then to make the correct choices, the one that people like Anakin couldn't make before. And so there's a sense where time matters still, you know, but the amount of time it can take for something to happen doesn't necessarily matter. Does that make any sense at all?
Yes. Yeah, it does. Probably because we've both spent so much time studying the sacred Jedi texts, as it were, in the Clone Wars and everything, going along with that. But, I really hope that there is a thread to come. And I do have a little bit of hope, because there's a theory I've started to entertain that I think sort of has to do with this as it pertains to The Rise of Skywalker, which, of course, hasn't come out as we're recording this. I'll be interested to see if it plays out, because this very issue of time and the temporal versus spiritual world is a thread that was very much pursued in Rebels and seems as if it could tie into The Rise of Skywalker. Now, you know, it's speculation game at this point, sort of thing, but I would really like to see this sort of, regardless of where it is, you know, it could be the Cassian Andor show for all that I care. I want to see a little bit more exploration of this in Star Wars to get back to that idea of, what's important versus what's passing.
See, this is the thing I think is really interesting, too, because going back to this old original thing, you know, people kind of somewhat complaining about, you know, why is Obi-Wan look so old? And, you know, and when you start to think about the idea that he is on a completely different planet, that the time difference makes sense. You know, he's on Tatooine for, you know, 20 years of Luke's life. 20 Tatooine years may be different than the Coruscant years. And obviously... And absolutely, those... you think about it, the time on that planet is 100% different than the weather and all that. I mean, when you just start to think about the kind of the reality of being on a completely different planet for 20 years, I mean, Obi-Wan grew up on Coruscant, basically.
Well, I can also tell you that living in a sunnier climate, it, you know, to borrow a line from Jar Jar, this sun doing murder to Misa's skin. Trust me, it's a thing. I'm going to look like
it's
a...
Very true. I'm gonna look like I grew up in Texas, I know.
Yeah, I'm going to look like a football in another 5 years. But I can say that you've hit on a really interesting note with that when I think about it, because we know Luke is, you know, 18-ish years old. But if Tatooine is moving at a different, you know, pace or whatever, this could explain, aside from the different environments they come up in, aside from that, setting that aside, it could explain something as previously mystifying about, say, Luke and Leia. Why is one so much more mature and one seems like a little acting a little young for his age? Well, it could be that compared to the galaxy at large, Luke is, by comparison, you know, 15. Although in standard years, he's 20. Or something like that. And I know that's a stretch, but I think it's an interesting stretch to take, because a simple conversation about birthdays got us to that point. And I think that's the you've stumbled on like a very novel way to resolve what would seem like a time continuity error in other storylines. I think that's this should be submitted to the Headcanon Council for consideration.
Well, and you kind of think about, too, just to go off of that for a second, I mean, Leia has also spent her life traveling in space.
Mm-hmm.
You know, she, as she gets older, she spends time on Coruscant. We know that from the Leia of Princess of Alderaan book, you know, she begins in the Senate and everything. So it's like that difference of time travel in the sense of, I mean, traveling through time in hyperspace, that also makes time different. So, you know, if we're really going to play with all this, there's so much that allows, like, things to happen and people to either look older or younger or whatever. And it's just kind of fun to think about, you know. And in the end, like, it's one of those parts where, you know, for the way that Lucas kind of set up his universe... the reality of time didn't really make a difference. Like it felt more like the entire galaxy is all happening on one galactic time scale. But when you think about these kind of things, it does make it kind of fun. And it does like help explain little things that might be different, or like why at one point, you know, like you said, people thought Leia was 20 and Luke was 18, you know.
Yeah, well, so, blame 20th Century Fox's press kit for that one back in 1977.
You know, so, I mean, all of that kind of stuff, but it gives us just as fans, it's like it's just fun to kind of think about those little things.
Mm-hmm.
And what I love about it, too, is that it doesn't matter in the end to the actual story.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I think that's one of the things that's, that we sometimes forget as fans, is that the minutia like this, it's enjoyable to talk about, but it's not a plot hole. It doesn't ruin anything, because that's not the point of the story, you know.
And amen. And
Star
hallelujah.
Wars is so much more than that. So, you know, I don't want anybody to hear us like talk about these things and think, oh my gosh, they're ruining things, you know.
Oh no,
no, this no. is yeah. In the sense, like, I don't want anybody to use that as ammunition.
Oh, I
because we're just yeah. having a good time,
right? This is. This is where we love to operate, which is the fun conversations that you have when you're just sitting down and throwing a couple of ideas around. It doesn't change a single molecule of the enjoyment of the series at all. It's just a fun conversation starting with a discussion about birthdays, because one of the Jedi Masters turned older as we're recording this, and I couldn't be... Listen, no, before you jump in, I want to say, all right, you're going to get your special one here. Birthdays always seem like a good time to declare. I'm so incredibly grateful for the person on the other microphone as my friend, as my podcasting partner, as my compatriot, as my fellow Star Wars fan. I couldn't be happier to have crossed paths with you, and I'm extremely grateful that we spend this time together every week, and that anybody wants to take the time to listen to us blather on at each other.
Well, apparently on Twitter we'll be crossing sabers one day. So
I want you to plan appropriately is all I'm saying.
I appreciate that, and I feel exactly the same way. You know, it's the fact that Star Wars brought us together as friends and brothers is been just a joy for me, and you know, getting to do this every week is so much fun. I was going to bring up one more time thing because
please.
I was thinking about, you know, people complained about the way that the Wookiees look in Solo and how they looked kind of weird, right? And I was thinking to myself, too, like, that's another place where time and planet environment could really, like,
yeah.
change somebody completely to where they don't look the same. And I think, you know, that specifically, I mean... Just look at our own species and what people look like when they came out of concentration camps. They barely looked human from what we recognize as human.
Right.
And so that's exactly what those Wookiees have been through on that planet, and who knows how long they've been there. So, I mean, you know, I feel like sometimes we as fans, we are kind of hard on the weird things like that. We're like, oh, it doesn't look like a Wookiee. It looks more like a Planet of the Apes. And it's like... But just a slight amount of thought, you're like, oh, well, okay, well, there, you know, that's where this kind of minutia, it's like, no, if you just put a little bit of thought into that, it actually makes complete sense why they don't look like Chewbacca.
Yeah, well, at that moment. And who says that every Wookiee looks the same? A Wookiee from a different part of the planet, there might have been evolutionary
Very
differences
true.
Between the two of them.
Yeah. Absolutely.
They're still Wookiees. They just look a little different. You know, but I'm on board with you in those terms. They've been through hell, and I doubt that they were being fed particularly well while they were there.
Right.
You know?
And, I mean, they're, like, underground, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, it's just, like, the environment is 100% diametrically opposed to the environment, you know, you get on Kashyyyk and stuff like that. So that is where I, you know, as we're talking about, like, you can get too wrapped up in the minutiae and whatnot. I think this is one of those areas where it's like, no, that can actually really help you enjoy the story more, too. And so mm-hmm. there's both sides to it, and I like the way that we do it, where it's like it's meant to enhance the story, not distract from it.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Well, if anybody else wants to track you down and maybe dispute some of these finer points about time and our understanding of it as it pertains to the Star Wars galaxy, Matt, where can they find you online?
Well, you can find me here on Twitter, Instagram, Letterboxd, and Vero under the name MattRushing02. You can also find me here on the network doing Owl Post with Drea Kaufman. We talk about Harry Potter each and every week, but one chapter at a time. We are actually getting very close to being done with the Order of the Phoenix. We only have, I think, 6 chapters left, so it's pretty awesome.
Best book of the series.
It's so good. I mean, we are at that point where, like, I just want to keep reading and I have to stop myself to mm-hmm. keep from reading. And then you can find me over on the Trek FM network. I'm doing two shows. One is called The Orb with Chris Jones, talking about Star Trek Deep Space Nine. I do our general geek show called The 602 Club, and that's where we just talk about all the different fandoms we love. So, you know, Marvel and DC and Star Wars and Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings. And I mean, the list is kind of endless. So go check that out. And the last but not least, I am doing a show called Cinema Stories. And that is where I'm talking about films, but through the lens of faith. And I do that with my good friend Courtney. So, John, where can everybody find you, and what else have you got going on that people need to be checking out?
Oh, I don't have very much else going on. You can find Kessel Junkie on your social network of choice. I lurk on Twitter. Sometimes I get a little active on there, but only momentarily. But mainly look for Kessel Junkie over on Letterboxd and Goodreads, the occasional piece over on KesselJunkie.com. And then, of course, you can check me out here on the network, co-hosting a week-by-week, release-by-release discussion show about the year 1994. It's a show called Retro Perspective, which I co-host with the inimitable Mike Schindler, and we get into gloriously odd discussions about the movies that came out in 94, including Forrest Gump and The Lion King. And boy, it's just going to continue to be a really interesting year, because 94 saw some wild releases. So that's where you can find me. But all of that said, you know, Master Rushing, I think I got to rush you back to the temple for your birthday cake cutting. So I think it's time to close these negotiations.
John, negotiations are closed.
Join the revolution. Join the Nerd Party.